In this clip, we will first look at the differential equations that govern transport of heat in the soil. Next, we will explain how these equations can be used to describe the variation of soil temperature with depth and time if the soil temperature is exposed to a sinusoidal forcing. The soil heat flux forms one of the terms in the surface energy balance. It is the transport of heat between the top of the soil and the soil at greater depth. Heat transport in the soil occurs by conduction, so when there is a temperature gradient, this will lead to heat transport. The temperature gradient and the heat flux are related through the thermal conductivity. This thermal conductivity is the first soil thermal property that we encounter, but more will follow. Note that we define a downward soil heat flux as positive. In fact, in our sign convention, for the surface energy balance, we take a net radiation towards the surface as positive, while all other fluxes are considered positive when they leave the surface. To accommodate this sign convention, we use a special vertical coordinate in the soil. We call it ZD, which is depth rather than height. So ZD increases positively with depth. The next differential equation we introduce describes what is the effect when the soil heat flux changes with depth. Imagine a soil column where more heat enters at the top than leaves the column at the bottom. In that case, heat is left behind in the column and it will heat up. This is exactly what the equation tells us. If there is a negative divergence of the soil heat flux, the left-hand side, then there is a positive temperature tendency. The soil thermal property that connects the two is the volumetric heat capacity, or the product of soil density and specific heat capacity. Both differential equations that we just introduced can be combined into a diffusion equation. This eliminates the soil heat flux from the equation. The diffusion equation links the time rate of change of the soil temperature to the curvature, or second derivative, of the soil temperature profile. Here, the soil thermal property that connects both terms is appropriately called the thermal diffusivity. Since the diffusion equation was derived from the equation for conduction and the equation for heat flux divergence, the diffusivity can be directly linked to the conductivity and the heat capacity. In the differential equations that describe the link between spatial temperature variations, temporal temperature variations, and heat transport, we have encountered a number of soil thermal properties. First, we have the soil thermal conductivity, which describes how easily heat is transported at a given temperature gradient. A high conductivity implies a large heat transport for a given temperature gradient. The volumetric heat capacity describes how the net heat supply to the soil, through the divergence of the soil heat flux, results in a temperature change. For a soil with a high volumetric heat capacity, the temperature will change less for a given heat supply than for a soil with a lower heat capacity. In some cases, especially when the thermal properties of the constituents of the soil are concerned, for instance the matrix or the water in the soil, specific heat capacity is used, that is, the heat capacity per unit mass. Finally, the thermal diffusivity describes how easily spatial temperature variations are smeared out. All of these thermal properties depend, sometimes in a complex way, on the composition of the soil matrix, the air and water content of the soil, and the arrangement of the soil particles. Now that we know the underlying differential equations for heat transport, it is time to see if we can learn something useful from them when we solve them. We will start here from the diffusion equation for temperature. To solve it, we need to impose boundary conditions. First, the upper boundary condition. Here we assume a sinusoidal variation of the surface temperature. Although not exact, it is a reasonable approximation to what happens on the diurnal timescale or on the yearly timescale. This imposed temperature varies around the mean temperature over bar T. The amplitude is A0, which is the amplitude at the surface. The temporal variation of the sine wave is dictated by the frequency omega. Depending on the period of the variation we are looking at, this omega can have different values. Now the lower boundary condition. Here we assume that at very large depth, the temporal temperature variation has vanished and the temperature is simply equal to the mean temperature. The solution of the diffusion equation under the given boundary conditions is the sinusoidal variation again. But a few things have changed relative to the variation at the surface. The amplitude now depends on depth. At larger depth, the amplitude is smaller. It decreases exponentially with depth. We also see that the sign now contains a phase shift. The temperature variation at the surface and at a given depth are not in sync. We see that both the exponential decay of the amplitude and the phase shift contain a parameter d, the so-called damping depth. The damping depth is in fact a combination of a number of parameters that occurred in the original diffusion equation and in its imposed boundary condition. The frequency, omega, stems from the forcing at the surface, whereas the diffusivity stems from the diffusion equation itself. The damping depth can be interpreted as an e-folding depth, the depth at which the amplitude of the temperature variation at the surface has decreased to 1 over e of the surface amplitude. So at d, the amplitude is about 1/3 of the surface amplitude. But this implies that below depth d, there is still a considerable variation of the temperature. So to summarize, we have seen that the transport of heat can be described by a set of three differential equations. Soil thermal properties determine how the soil temperature and the heat flux are related for a specific soil. Thermal properties depend in a complex way on soil properties. Finally, the diffusion equation can be solved for a simple boundary condition. If we apply a sine wave at the surface, like the diurnal cycle or the yearly cycle, we obtain a simple solution. That solution contains one essential parameter, the damping depth, which can be interpreted as an e-folding depth.